Give me a dozen healthy infants, well-formed, and my own specified world to bring them up in, and I'll guarantee to take any one at random and train him to become any type of specialist I might select. Doctor, lawyer, artist, merchant, chief, and yes, even beggarman and thief, regardless of his talents, penchants, tendencies, abilities, vocations, and race of his ancestors. I am going beyond my facts, and I admit it, but so have the advocates of the contrary, and they have been doing it for many thousands of years, said John B. Watson. John Bradus Watson was born in 1878 in South Carolina, growing up as a poor student living on a farm. His father was a violent, unruly man, leading many people to believe that John would grow up in his father's footsteps. However, John B. Watson turned out to be a boy with strong drive and courage of self-promotion. When he was 16 years old, he enrolled in Furman University, and 5 years later, he received his master's degree. Then in 1913, he went on to the University of Chicago, where he received his PhD in psychology. Next, he became professor of experimental and comparative psychology at Johns Hopkins University. While at Johns Hopkins University, he began studying the behaviors of animals and humans and concluded that though they operate on the same principles, humans were much more complicated than animals. In 1913, Watson published an article outlining his ideas and basically established a new subject of psychology. Watson believed that since thoughts cannot be seen, they cannot be studied. Therefore, he started focusing on behavior because it could be observed in a tangible way. Other psychologists of the time believed that heredity was a significant factor in shaping human behavior. So Watson's ideas on behaviorism came as a shock to the psychologist community. The goal of Watson's behavior theory was set on the ideas of the things people do rather than what they experience. John Watson said, "Psychology, as the behaviorists view it, is purely objective, experimental branch of natural science. Its theoretical goal is the prediction and control of behavior. Introspection forms no essential part of its methods, nor the scientific value of data depend upon the readiness with which they lend themselves to the interpretation in terms of consciousness." Watson believed that it's possible to develop a general explanation for any behavior based on the classical conditioning principles. To prove this, Watson embarked on a study with Rosalie Rayner and a 9-month-old little Albert. Albert was a healthy, normally developed child who was fairly unemotional. The object of this study was to see if he could classically condition the child to experience a strong emotional reaction of fear. During the study, Watson showed little Albert a variety of stimuli and recorded his reactions as indifferently curious but with little fear. In the next step of the study, little Albert was presented with a white rat, this time accompanied with a loud striking noise. Watson did this repetitively every time Albert would reach out to touch the rat. The pairing of the rat and the loud noise was produced over and over through different trials. Ultimately, just the sight of the white rat made little Albert tremble in fear, scrambling to get away from it. The goal of his study was reached when Watson proved that emotion could be produced through classical conditioning and behavioral ideas. Little Albert provided a chance to demonstrate the strong influence of environment even during the early stages of life. The study was set the stage for behaviorism and eventually allowed it to dominate the field of psychology. Today, his concepts of behavior are still widely used in therapy and behavior training to help people change their behaviors and develop new skills. In the classroom, learning occurs as a result of responses to the stimuli that are reinforced through feedback. Teachers can help students learn by conditioning them through clearly identifying the desired behaviors and appropriate reinforcers. During class time, if the teacher desires for students to always raise their hand before getting out of their seat or making a comment, the teacher should reinforce by verbally praising the child after they raise their hand, saying, "Thank you for raising your hand," to allow the child to feel proud of their actions. Another approach a teacher could take to foster comments during class discussion would be participation points. These points need to be clearly recorded with feedback given to the students so that they have a drive to participate. John Watson's ideas have been taken and improved over the years into modern theories for teaching today. Peter A. Cooper explained that Watson's ideas on feedback as reinforcement have been subject to some criticism, as research has emerged demonstrating that under certain circumstances, delayed feedback is more effective than immediate feedback. Students, it appears, spend more time studying feedback if it is delayed than if it is presented immediately after difficult material has been presented. In a classroom setting, instant gratification isn't always the best answer because it doesn't allow students to really stretch and reach for their goals. It is important that as behaviorist ideas are applied in the classroom today, that they are tailored to the specific needs of each student in the room. The behaviorist approach to teaching brings positive feelings to the students because it allows them to feel proud of their successes and allows them to nurture a yearning to change their behaviors to satisfy the actions they have learned to value while avoiding disappointment from the teacher. Behavior is a learned trait, meaning it can also be unlearned and relearned. John B. Watson evolved the field of psychology and teaching through the study of people with his understanding that human behavior is powerfully influenced by environment and reinforcement.